Just 3 months ago, I was standing right here in what I think is the most beautiful forest on the entire planet. And I was standing here with a man named Tai Zhihong, who we call Tai Shushu. And he has worked here in the Galigong National Nature Reserve of China's Yunnan province for most of his life, only going home no more than 5 days a month to protect this incredible, beautiful place. And this is one of my favorite photos from the Galigong. It's kind of from this bug's eye view, looking up at the canopy spreading above us. And that morning, as we hiked into this and the sunlight was filtering through the trees and birdsong erupted around us, I've never felt more connected to nature. But the Galigong isn't just pretty. It's also one of the most biodiverse areas in the entire country of China, and also a recognized international conservation hotspot across the world. In fact, even though the Galigong only takes up 1%, less than 1% of China's land, it has 17% of all of China's plant species can be found right here in this forest that's represented in this picture. And it's also critical to our lives here in Chengdu. Chengdu is the 43rd largest CO2 emitting city on the planet. And it's not surprising given the large population here. But the carbon and the CO2 stored in the Galigong is even more than all of us in Chengdu emit each year. So we can live our lives in the city of Chengdu conveniently because forests and places like the Galigong exist, not just because of their beauty, but because of what they do for the planet. But when I was there for 6 days, we did more than just admire the beauty. We found something else. I'm going to share a one-minute video with you, and this is what we found.
Today
'Skywalker' gibbons. And they're called that because they live their whole lives without ever touching the ground in the treetops and the canopies of the forest. And they were actually only just discovered in 2017 as a new species in the Galigong. And every morning, we would track the gibbons from morning till dusk. And when they woke up around 7 a.m., they would sing from about 8 to 9. And they would first start in a small group in the tree they were in. And when they would sing, the gibbons across the mountain and the other valley would respond, and the song would be echoing across the entire mountain. And they're absolutely one of the most amazing species I've ever had the privilege and the honor of working with. But they're also a lot like us humans, and they really remind us sometimes of ourselves. And they're also the closest genetic ancestor to us. So the gibbon in the black, he is the male, and we called him Agong. And the other gibbon, who's a lighter fur, we called her Ama. And they're male and female, and just like humans, they tend to mate for life, so they stay together for life. And it was really funny, because during the day, they'd wake up, And it actually tended to be Amma who made most of the decisions in the relationship, right? So they would go and find food from tree to tree, and it would be Amma who would be bringing Agong to another tree to find food. And when they would stop and rest, it would be, like this picture, Agong who would be grooming, massaging Amma. And when Amma had enough of it, she would kind of look up and kind of hit Agong, and then Agong would look at actually the camera with this kind of dejected, confused face as what he did wrong. And so they're very human. They remind a lot of ourselves and our own relationships as well. But this picture shows two things. One, it shows that Amma, she's very old. And two, if you can see, she has an injured eye. And that's actually because she's very old and she's actually at the end of her lifespan. She only has 5 to 10 years more to live. And her situation is very representative of the entire situation that the Skywalker Gibbons now face on our planet today. There's only 150 or less Skywalker Gibbons left in the Galagong and on the planet. And in our generation or the next, they'll probably go extinct. And this is very representative of the climate crisis and biodiversity crisis that we're facing today. We are losing species every day, and the planet continues to warm, challenging our planet's ecosystem and all the species on it. And I could tell you these things, but you probably already have some sort of opinion and knowledge of these facts. And my job as a photographer is not just to tell you what is going wrong and what is going wrong on our planet, but to show you the beauty of the places still worth protecting and what we can actually do about those places. For example, I could sit here and tell you that the hot pot that you're going to have tonight with Maldu and Yachang and Nahuar, right? It's great and it's delicious, but it contributes to the meat industry. And the meat industry contributes to 12 to 18% of all greenhouse gas emissions on the entire planet. But it's not good to just focus on the negatives. So I want to show you some of the beauty in China that's worth protecting. I've been here for 5 years, and the next video is a 1-minute video that in 5 years is going to bring you through all the conservation sites I've been in China, the most beautiful places, and those that are protecting them, and also what they're doing about it. So, when you see these images, I really hope that, like me, you see how beautiful these places are and you have an urge to go do something about it and protect them. That's the goal of my photography. But it only matters because all of you are already right here, right? You're already in the room, so you can see these images. But if you didn't see these images, if no one was to see them, they wouldn't matter, no matter how good they were. So the secret of photography is not just taking great images, but it's actually conveying them and getting an audience to see those images. It's not just being an artist, but it's also being a communicator. And when we talk about conservation communication, we're talking about two different groups. One group can be represented by the green circle. So this green circle is the people that really, really care about conservation. They don't just care, but they're also giving time. And they're giving money, and they're giving resources to conservation movements or organizations. And there's a bigger group, though. And this bigger group is the blue circle, Right? And these are people who may or may not care about conservation, but regardless, they're not giving time or money or resources actively to support the cause. And of course, the Green Group, their biggest goal is to increase their resources in order to protect the Earth even better. So they want to communicate between the two groups, right? They're trying to establish communication to get more people from the Blue Group to join the Green Group and support them with more resources. But there's a communication barrier. Especially from where I'm from in the US, there are still many, many people who do not believe that climate change is real or that we need to act upon it. And so communication breaks down so many times between the environmental group and those who are not active. And we need to think about why that is and how we can address that problem. So here's an explanation. Science actually shows us that people are divided in how they think into two different ways. One group is much more altruistic. They don't just think about themselves and their own groups, but they think about the world outside of them. Not just other countries and other ethnicities, but also animals as well, and the welfare of our planet as a whole. Right? And so the Green Group, one of their highest values is altruism and love for the planet and protecting it. So it's no surprise that they would give. The Blue Group, well, they also value many things, and they're totally normal. Family. One of their highest priorities is family and friends and people who are very, very close to them. Supporting those groups are the most important people and goals in their life. Another is convenience, right? They want a car to go to work. They want to arrive at work on time on their own schedule. They want to take a vacation when they can. I think we can all relate to that as well. And then lastly, status quo, right? They care about keeping the status quo and they don't want to see things change. They like things how they are, and they don't want to accept that the Earth might be changing around them, and they just want things to go on as normal. And I think many of us have also been there as well. So when we consider that these groups and their values are different, we come to a crucial problem in regards to conservation communication. That's that 环保不仅是对生态与生物科学的挑战，也是对心理和社会科学的挑战. All right. Thank you. 谢谢. Conservation isn't just about hard science. It's also about connecting and reaching people. 谢谢. And that's why there's REN, right? Instead of thinking about people in these circles as isolated value boxes, we need to think of them as individuals. Because at the end of the day, people in the Green Circle also care about family, they also care about convenience, and they will also care about the status quo. And the people in the Blue, at some level, they definitely do care about the environment and can appreciate the beauty of nature. And so instead of seeing it as unbreachable value boxes, we need to see it as people-to-people connection. And that's how we establish efficient communication. We look for similarities with individuals instead of being boxed out by the differences that we have. And that's when we make conservation communication work, and we draw more people into the group that's actively donating and caring and supporting the environment. So let me give you some examples from my own work. This is one of the most beautiful sunrises I have ever experienced on the Tibetan Plateau. So I was camping here at around 4,200 meters, when I woke up, it was a clear sky. As the sun rose, mist started appearing from the ground, almost rising up, then flowing over the hills like water. And then actually this person in the frame, that's actually myself. And I was so inspired by the view, I just went and ran, and it was just absolutely incredible and awe-striking. Right? And these kind of images inspire, in particular, one group of people. And that's people who care about and love recreation in the outdoors. They're people who hike, and who ski, and who rock climb, and who run. They're one of the easiest targets and biggest targets that conservation groups can go after. And studies in the US have actually shown this. They've compared two groups. They've compared a group of people that only go and visit national parks as tourists, and they compare a group that goes to wild places with a backpack and hike for multi-day trips. And they found that the group that actually hike for multi-day trips engaged in nature by themselves give much, much, much more money to conservation groups and those who just visit national parks as tourists. Right, so people who are actively involved in nature, and that group of people, whether it be athletes or hobbyists, are one of the biggest groups that we can target as conservation communicators and draw similarities between. So here's an example. Two photos. One photo is of a Tibetan monk. He's scaling a cliff, and the other photo is of a North Face-sponsored athlete who's also scaling a cliff. And the difference here isn't in elevation. It's not in danger. In fact, they're almost at the same exact elevation. It's what they're doing it for, and it's what they're wearing. The monk is doing this to take a photo of a rare bird species in China. And the athlete is doing this for pure fun. There's nothing wrong with that. And the monk is wearing his traditional Tibetan clothes, and the athlete is wearing full protective gear, a helmet, a harness, a rope. But at the end of the day, their activity is exactly the same, but their goals and methods are different. But we can convince the outdoor community and show them that actually conservation is exploration. And people who explore are also doing conservation. And draw similarities between these two groups is how we prove that we're actually one and the same and we should be supporting each other. But conservation is one of the hardest things I've ever done. And it goes through forests full of wet bamboo and leeches and slippery slopes. So this photo is from 2017, and it's from Sichuan. It's from a small nature reserve in Sichuan that has some of the highest panda conservation in all of China. And it's also from one of my hardest expeditions outdoors. So we were supposed to be out for a certain amount of time, but we were on a ridge at about 3,000 meters, it started snowing. It had been raining that whole day, and it was early fall, and none of us had been prepared for such low temperature. And as it started to snow, many of our team started to get hypothermic and showing signs of hypothermia, uncontrollable shivering, loss of direction. And we actually got lost on that ridge. And we ended up having to go down the mountain without a path and spend the night with all of our gear and clothes and everything soaking wet, sleeping under a cave. No real shelter, no tents, wet sleeping bags. All we had was a fire to keep us warm. And we had no food either. And that was when I realized not just how hard and difficult conservation is, but also that beyond connecting people and people, we connect people and companies. These people are in need of bigger support than just individuals can give. And that's why I've now started to connect bigger companies to conservation issues. So I work with the North Face and Sony. They're some of my sponsors. And right now, the North Face is sponsoring these outdoor gear groups with the gear they need, right? Sleeping bags, tents, waterproof gear. Whatever they need, North Face supplies them, bringing in an even bigger company to support groups that would never have that support otherwise. And also Sony. Sony is now sharing my images and these stories of these people to their entire audience on social media in China. And perhaps this audience, perhaps some of them already cared about conservation, but it's really the larger photography audience in a whole. And now all of them are seen and getting exposed to these issues that matter so much. So pulling in companies can not just bring in actual physical support, but it can massively widen the amount of people and the size of the circle that is actually looking and caring about these issues. And there's one more example I like to give, and it's one of the more wilder examples from my work. And a bit crazier, but it's also incredibly important. Going from companies to talking about people and creative interest groups. So here's one more video that I'm going to show you.
What's up, guys? I'm here at 5,421 meters.
led you home through the city lights. We were rebels on rooftops of mom's apartment. Held you close cause you're scared of heights.
Gong Gai Shui Shan, tallest mountain in Sichuan.
Before midnight, if 10 to play. But I'm like you, baby. Anywhere you want, I wish you were mine. In the broad daylight, but you just you. Oh, oh, I will never let you down. Woo!
This is pretty ridiculous, and I have no plans on quitting my photography day job to be a dancer. I don't think it would work out very well if I did. But the point of this is that these three videos online got millions of views. And I'm definitely one of the worst videos online, or worst dancers online. And they got millions of views because they were funny, they were creative, they were weird, and they were funny to look at and laugh at. And they also got shared on one of the actual dance studios' social media accounts that the choreography was from. And I can guarantee you that a lot of the people following that dance studio maybe had no interest or was thinking about conservation when they clicked on that video. They just wanted to see a Lao Wai or a Wai Guo Ren dancing on top of a mountain and being funny, you know? And that's why they clicked on the video. But there's an environmental message in that video. And then it got tons of shares and tons of engagements. So it's not just something funny, but it's something creative, right? Beyond just people and people, and people and companies, we all have our own social groups. We have our own hobbies. We have our own networks. You may be a painter, you may be a singer, you may be a dancer, right? You have a hobby. And I think there's so many creative ways to tie in small, subtle conservation messages to anything you like to do. And it's our responsibility to find those creative ways. You don't have to be a scientist to communicate conservation. All you need to do is be in your own community and find ways to tie in conservation with what you love, and people will enjoy it. So there's one more photo that I want to share with today. And this is a photo that no one has seen before, except maybe my girlfriend, who I gave her a preview when I was practicing. But this photo actually just took about 3 days ago. And it is from the border of one of China's newest national parks. And this is a conservationist who is a local person, and he works in the national park in that nature reserve as a forest ranger. And as you can see, he's rappelling down this rock cliff. And you can't see the full height of it, but it's about a 10 to 20 meter drop. So if you fall, the consequences could be deadly. And for this photo, we used a rope just for safety. But as I was talking to them and understanding their work more, he told me that before they never used ropes. If they encountered a situation like this, they would simply scale up or scale down and use their hands. And I asked them, weren't you terrified? And they said, yeah. It was one of those scary things we have to do in our work, but it's worth it. And so I have the greatest respect for these conservationists who are actually in nature themselves doing the work, risking their lives for conservation. But I can tell you this, if we don't do conservation ourselves, it's actually all of our lives and our planet and our way of life that's at risk. And that's why it's so important when we talk about the way and the future and how to actually communicate conservation. It's so important to think about these three things. Ren, Yu Ren, people and people. Ren, Yu Qiye, people and companies. And Ren, Yu Shehui, you and society. We can all be ambassadors for conservation in our own communities and help spread the values and the need to protect the planet. What will you do? Xiexie.